Hey guys, my name is Joanna and I teach the flute. Now, I didn't always want to be a teacher. I actually resisted even the idea of teaching for a long time. I just felt like I never would get to the point in my life where I would know enough to teach people how to play this instrument. So why did I start teaching? I have this friend from church who plays the piano professionally. He is both a performer and a teacher. And when I was 17 years old, he asked me if I would like to take on one of his piano students as my flute student. And I mean, come on, when you're 17, you can't really exactly say no to free money. And so that's how I fell into teaching. I actually worked in a studio for 3 years. While I was in school, I actually got the job when I was 19, right smack on my 19th birthday. It's now been many years since I've graduated from university. So yes, I have been teaching for a long time now. And throughout all these years, I have noticed that probably the weirdest part of teaching an instrument is that there is really no formula for teaching. Each student that you get is unique and has a unique background. So the way that you teach one student, you can't actually directly apply to another student because they may not receive your teaching in the same way. Each student also learns at a different pace. Every student's mouth formation, basically where the teeth are placed inside of their mouth, how big their tongue is, how long their tongue is, everything that is going on inside of their mouth is not the same as yours. Things will actually feel a little bit different for them blowing into the instrument than it does for you. Are you kind of seeing where I'm going with this? Each flute is also different. If you guys have seen my Flute Center of New York sponsored review videos, you will know that I always, always stress the importance of this fact. Yes, indeed, every single flute out there plays differently. My experience reviewing flutes for the Flute Center of New York has been incredibly revealing. I have not known to this degree how differently each flute plays. Some flutes, you will feel the air spinning in your mouth in the middle. Some you feel it spinning in the front. Some you feel it spinning in the back. For some flutes, you even have to move that spinning ball of air in your mouth depending on the register that you're playing in. Angling the air out of your mouth is also different for every single flute. And that doesn't even cover how different each flute plays. That's just scratching the surface. And so now I realize why there are so many conflicting schools of thought when it comes to how to play the flute. And it is because there are literally many conflicting ways of playing the flute depending on the flutes that you choose to play. It's starting to take a good 2 to 3 hours for me to figure out each flute that comes in through my door. Sometimes I play it for a bit, for maybe 15 minutes, and I just can't get it to ring and I have to put it down and just kind of do something else and come back to it later. And then sometimes some things will just click. Given all of this, how do you teach the flute? Is there even a standard? I have heard that a lot of teachers will get their students to purchase flutes from one specific brand. And that one specific brand usually happens to be the exact brand that that teacher plays. Now, why would you do this consciously or subconsciously? It's pretty self-explanatory, right? You can't actually apply the way you play the flute exactly on one flute to another. You actually can't do that. I mean, you can make a sound, but it's not going to sound great. It's not going to be at the potential that that particular flute can play. So getting all of your students to play the exact same brand of flute as you creates a very concrete way of teaching for the teacher. They know exactly what to teach each of their students to make their flutes ring. It makes sense. But of course, I have heard of many other teachers. I am included in this group of teachers who will let their students purchase the flute that works for them the best. But the problem that you run into is that if you as the teacher don't know how to make their flute ring, you will run into a few headaches here and there. You will notice that your student is following everything that you are teaching them, Plus, they are practicing every day. You know, these are some of your like most hardworking students, and they are just not improving. Sometimes when you're teaching them, their tone gets worse, but you can tell that they're doing exactly what you're telling them to do. I have been guilty of this. I have done this to a couple of students until I accidentally ended up asking for their specific brand of flute from the Flute Center of New York for me to play around with. And then I discovered that I was actually teaching them the wrong way to create a lovely tone on their flute. So of course this made me realize that probably one of the reasons why my master's teacher, Linda Lucas, taught me so well is because we actually have the same flute. She had a different head joint from me, but the flute was from Brannan. We opened up our flutes next to each other and they look like twin flutes. Linda Lucas herself is the second flutist of the San Francisco Symphony, and I really enjoy playing second and third flute too. So not only do our interests in terms of orchestral positions line up, I am also guessing that maybe we were attracted to Brannan flutes because our natural mouth formation works for Brannan flutes, which means that my natural mouth formation probably matches Linda's mouth formation pretty similarly. No one's the same, but we're probably pretty darn similar. I think the reason why it works so well between us is because she was literally just an older, wiser version of myself. Not only mentally, but probably physically. I mean, revelation. My mind was blown when I discovered this. So what do you do as a teacher then? I have been wrestling with this for the last couple of years, and especially over the last couple of months, now that I have been working with the Flute Center of New York. And I realized that I had to change my teaching style a little bit. I had learned from my university days that the human body is really, really amazing in that if you are goal-oriented, so if you hear a specific tone quality and you want to imitate it, you want to match it, your body will actually naturally be able to produce that tone for you. This also applies to tuning, so if you hear other people playing and you want to blend into them, as long as you think of it as blending into them, you will end up tuning perfectly with them. And so now I actually play a little bit more for my students because I want them to be goal-oriented in terms of how I want them to sound, how I want them to tongue. So this of course means that there's actually a lot of self-teaching on the part of the student. And thinking back, I realized that this is very much the case. When I was a kid, I mentioned a couple of videos ago that I spent an entire summer just studying low notes by myself. And it was in that time that I experimented enough to figure out how to make my little Yamaha student flute ring. I came back after the summer, went back to lessons, and my teacher was like, "Wow, I love your low notes." And I let her think that it was because I was following exactly what she was saying, when in actuality, I was not following what she said at all, but I just pretended like I was going along with her. In university, I had a very similar experience where my teacher was having a lot of trouble figuring out why my right hand in particular was always locking up. She kept trying to change my right hand posture so that I can play fast and evenly, but I just was actually never able to play completely evenly on my right hand. So I resorted to just staring at my friend's hands. Chris Hutchinson, if you're watching this, I stared at your hand so much. Paul Hung, if you're watching this video, I have stared at your hand far more than probably anyone else has ever stared at your hand. Because I was playing second flute to Paul, I had a wonderful full view of his right hand. I could see it at all angles, and I stared at that thing like there was no tomorrow. And I realized that the way that both Chris and Paul were playing the flute, the way that they were holding it, their hands were a lot more natural looking than mine. Their hands looked something like this, whereas my hand looked like this. I finally realized that meant that I needed something to push my thumb backwards. And so that's how I discovered that I should use a thumb port. I came in with a thumb port the next lesson after I received it, and I showed my teacher how I was playing with it, and she also could not deny it. It was like magic. I was suddenly able to play technical things on the flute evenly. I discovered by myself that my thumb is literally too short. So after thinking back and realizing that this is how I learned how to do a lot of things on the flute, I realized that I actually should not 100% control my own students. So I have actually been telling them that I want them to experiment with the way that they play the flute. Feel free to experiment. Feel free to self-teach, and I want them to report back to me what their findings are. Now that I know more of the possibilities there are for making a flute ring, now I can offer them more suggestions for them to play around with, just so that they don't have to start from complete scratch. All right, so if I'm allowing my students to self-teach, then what the heck is the point of me even being their teacher? All of us have blind spots. You will actually block out things that you're playing that aren't actually correct simply because you're not used to listening for them. As the teacher, you have more experience than your students. So your ear is actually sharper and more attuned to hearing and picking up mistakes, so that you can point it out to them so that they can be aware of it and then be able to fix it. As the teacher, you will be able to introduce and teach new concepts to them that they may not otherwise have access to. So things like conflicting schools of thought with regard to tone production, articulation, vibrato, even breathing. You'll also be able to find and fill in the gaps in musical knowledge, whether it be theory or music history. And you can introduce stylistic playing to your students. So things like how to make those quarter notes more bouncy in Baroque music. I mean, of course, I would use Baroque music as my first example because I kind of love Baroque music a little too much. Or how to do over-the-top crescendos in romantic music, and even just demonstrating the difference between a ritardando and a rallentando. You can also diagnose each individual student's unique weaknesses. Figure out what is causing that weakness to happen, and then verbally explain it to them. So a very common example of this is when you are getting your students to do some sort of very technical exercise and they trip up like crazy over like one or two bars. Now your job as the teacher is to figure out why they tripped up over those two bars. Is it because they are unfamiliar with that specific sequence of fingerings? Or is it because they lost all sense of the beat when they got there? Or maybe they were anticipating the sound of a major key, but what they're playing is in minor, so that just tripped them up like crazy. Or it could be an entirely different reason. So do teachers really know what they're doing? I'm just gonna put it out there that a lot of times I feel like I don't know what I'm doing. And I'm going to guess that for those of you who are watching this video who are also teachers, you probably also feel like you don't know what you're doing until you teach something to your students and you see their faces light up with understanding, and then you realize you actually taught them something useful. If you have ever felt like that, please leave a comment down below and share your story with us. If you are a student and you are wondering what is your teacher trying to teach you and you are confused about your lesson, also put that in the comments below. Maybe we can help you out together. But that is it for today. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, make sure you give me a big thumbs up and hit subscribe for new videos every Saturday. My last video is over there, and if you want to catch me during the week, my social media networks are down there. But otherwise, I will see you guys next week. Bye. All right, so I only did one test for this. Hopefully, this all works out. I changed the way I did my makeup. I watched so many makeup tutorials on photo ready, camera ready makeup. I attempted Instagram eyebrows.